And now, the mayor of the city of New York, the Honorable David N. Jenkins.
Thank you. Okay, Nagurney, I think this has gone far enough. Out of here.
Just one more question, Mr. Mayor.
No more question, that's it. Well, now that I see that the only reporter left covering this ceremony is Josh Mankiewicz, I don't ever have to worry about this getting on the air. I want to thank the Hilton for providing me with a delicious meal. I began with a crisp endive salad liberally sprinkled with caviar. Dinner was a perfect lobster thermidor. Oh, well, of course, I upgraded myself to first class. I want to take a moment to acknowledge some of the people I recognize in the room tonight. The former board of directors of Drexel, Burnham, Lambert. Ladies and gentlemen, let's give a big hand to your waiters. By the way, today I appointed several former Drexel executives to city government. That way, if the city goes broke, we can give ourselves big bonuses before we get thrown out. Before I came here tonight, I purchased a New York lottery ticket. Right there in the store, the committee offered me six numbers, from which I made the judgment to select two. I'll select the other four later. I saw something kind of sad on my way in tonight. It was a guy pleading at the door that he should be allowed in for free because he's an old friend of Norman Stiesel's. I told Ed Koch he'd have to pay just like everybody else. Well, this has been quite an evening. To tell you the truth, I've never seen such a furious flurry of wretched excess, disgusting taste, and vulgarity. And that was just Jerry Nachman. Eating his dinner. You know, standing before you, I think back to that night a little over 4 months ago, election night, when I received the greatest news I've ever heard. ABC had canceled the chicken soup. As long as I have the press in front of me, I'd like to thank the New York Post for their profile of my lovely bride, the grandmother of my grandchildren, Joyce Burroughs Dinkins. I especially appreciated the headline, "Best Sex I Ever Had." By the way, when you pick up tomorrow's Daily News, don't miss Marsha Kramer's piece about Manhattan's hundreds of Korean nail salons. As you all know, the New York Times has been having problems with their reporters giving advice to members of my team. First, Albert Scardino conferred with my campaign staff. Now it turns out that the Times travel editor has been giving Andy Stein help with travel arrangements. Did you know that the Newsday is the only New York daily with a full-time reporter assigned to the New York Hilton? I'm not sure about this, but I met a woman downstairs who said that she'd spent the afternoon on top of the news and ahead of the Times. We're a very open administration, as you know, and we wanted to make sure that a lot of the former members of the Koch administration were able to see tonight's program. So it's being shown closed circuit in prisons across the state. A lot of people have been worried that the federal government in Washington isn't interested in our city. I just want to say that since his visit a few weeks ago, Vice President Quayle calls me 4 or 5 times a week, asking if it's really true that New York is the name of both a city and a state. And by the way, just to follow up on Esteban Crichet's question about Vice President Quayle, I have news for you. As far as we know, he's not Hispanic. Well, I could stay up here all night, especially since I haven't even started calling names of all the people I recognize in the room. But it's time for my favorite news show, Leaks, Lies, and Videotape.
Hello, I'm Mary Tyler Moore. Before we begin, I'd like to make a short statement. The opinions expressed in tonight's comedy presentation are those of the performers and do not express the opinions of Mayor Dinkins, his administration, or the city of New York. Now, with that out of the way, I'd like to ask you something. Is it just me, or does everyone wish Ed Koch would just go away?
I'd just like to add here, the opinions I express tonight are also not my own.
You know, Chuck, that's a beautiful tie you're wearing. Is that paisley?
No, Kitey. It's a gorgeous mosaic.
First, the headlines. Gasoline sales in the city plummet as drivers begin to siphon fuel directly from New York Harbor. In Albany, Governor Cuomo proposes that the East River and the Hudson River be renamed Leaded and Unleaded.
Exxon unveils its new corporate slogan, "We cover the globe." And to honor the upcoming St. Patrick's Day celebrations, the Citgo Corporation announced that any oil spilled into the Arthur Kill this week will be colored green. Now for the stories behind the news.
A recent Columbia University study shows that the three things that most frighten New York school children are crime, drugs, and Gabe Pressman's hair.
In Nicaragua today, Daniel Ortega claimed that his loss in his country's recent elections could be attributed to one key factor, getting Jackie Mason to campaign for him.
Thank you, Ernie. This bulletin just in, there's been a water main break, this time on Fifth Avenue between 23rd and 27th Streets. Officials of the Perrier Corporation are heading to the scene.
Thank you, Michelle. A stunning revelation in the world of journalism today, as columnists Jimmy Breslin and Pete Hamill reveal that every time they want to quote some man on the street, regular Joe or working stiff, they simply call each other. Both men were all too available for further comment.
Thank you, Jim. There's a new book out this week that will be of interest to anyone with questions regarding proper etiquette in these modern times. Joining us is the author of The Collected Memos of the New York Board of Education, John Tobias. Thank you for joining us, John.
My pleasure.
So, tell us, where did you get the idea for the book?
Well, I realized that teachers and members of the educational establishment in New York face situations that all of us face day in and day out. And they've taken the time to prescribe strict rules of behavior in these everyday situations.
Such as?
Well, for example, what if you need to ask a child to surrender his or her handgun? It's right here. What's the proper etiquette for taking money out of a school budget for calling phone sex lines? Again. Or let's say you're at a school board meeting. Should everyone pay for the drugs up front? Or should they contribute to a kitty, like at the Mr. Coffee machine? Once again, it's all in here.
Is there anything in here that kids can use?
Sure. One memo here counsels kids on how to tell if their principal is on drugs. Anyway. For example, has he ever slammed you against a locker screaming, "Where's your hall pass?" Does he call everyone in school Mr., no matter what their name is? Is he paranoid, always convinced that people are misbehaving behind his back?
Sounds like room 9.
Exactly.
Thank you, John, for joining us.
My pleasure.
Back to you, Maury.
Don't worry about that. It's just Staten Island.
Officials, you take this one, Maury.
Official city economic figures today show that within 5 years, 40% of jobs in New York City will be held by college-educated workers. 35% will be held by people with a high school diploma. And 25% will be held by former Mayor Ed Koch. Now, with more on the economic news, let's go to our economic correspondent. Oh. Sorry, I haven't appointed anyone that job yet.
New Transit Chief Albert Keeper today announced his solution to crowding on the subway. As of Monday, the subway fare will be raised to $1.17. We can make change for about 6 people every hour, he said. That ought to ease things up.
In New York today, Council member Wendell Foster introduced a bill that would allow the mayor to fly first class on city business. Currently, New York City employees fly coach, and the fare is paid out of the city treasury, unless they're being flown to federal prison, in which case the U.S. government pays for it. Back to you, Roz.
A New York Times CBS News poll today revealed that most white people, when asked a question that even remotely relates to race, will lie to pollsters to hide the appearance of racism. In a related development, revised Nielsen ratings today released show The Cosby Show ranked number 65th, dead last.
I've just been handed a bulletin. There's been another water main break, this time on 8th Avenue and 17th Street. More on this later.
Now let's go to the Crime Watch with ace crime reporter John Miller reporting live from Little Italy.
Thank you, Rollin and Mary Ann. Since his latest acquittal, John Gotti has been called by many in our news media untouchable. And frankly, this makes me, it makes me sick. You know, we in the news media are supposed to call Gotti a reputed head of the Gambino crime family, or alleged. We all know that he's just a cheap thug and a murderer. That's right, Gotti, if you're watching. I'm calling you a murderer. And what are you going to do about it, Gotti, huh? Kill me? Well, go ahead, Gotti. Come on, kill me. Yeah, Gotti, kill me. But you know what? I don't think you've got the cojones. No, Gotti, why don't you send one of your big, fat, stupid Goomba goons to do it for you, huh? Or why don't you just have him break my kneecap? Now, in case your Goomba goons are too stupid to know what a kneecap is, it's right here between the thigh and the shin. Come on, Gotti. Huh? Come on, Gotti. Hey. Gotti. Hey. Gotti. Gotti, 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 Gotti. Bok, bok. Gotti. Oh, Gotti. Gotti, Gotti, Gotti.
John.
John. Hold
John.
It. Wait a minute.
Yes, yes.
John, do you realize what you're doing? You're on TV.
Well, Marianne, what's he going to do? Is he really going to hurt me?
Well, maybe somebody who just wants to impress him. See?
Odd. Mr. Gotti, I didn't mean any disrespect. What did I do?
John Miller would like me to say that was John Miller taunting Mr. Gotti, not Al Franken. Investigators have discovered a valuable clue in the mysterious gas that seems to be causing workers on the Triborough Bridge to experience nauseousness and dizziness. It seems that in the locker room last week, someone spilled a bottle of Cher cologne.
I've tried everything. It just won't stay put.
Cardinal John O'Connor today revealed that in a recent exorcism, the demonic spirit of former New York Post sports writer Dick Young was cast out from the body of Channel 2's Warner Wolf. Wolf first aroused suspicion when every other word he used on the air was druggy.
It's the 23rd day of the baseball lockout, and George Steinbrenner has fired his 10th manager since the lockout began. Said Steinbrenner, the team's just not making any progress.
There was excitement on the stage tonight in New York, so to hear all about it, let's go to our theater critic, Joseph Papp.
Well, thank you, Carol. I've just returned from this year's Inner Circle presentation entitled Have a Nice Dave. Now, this show can't be seen on Broadway or on television. It's a performance that's only meant to be done once. A lot like a frontal lobotomy. Quite a few of tonight's performers know about this from firsthand experience. Now, the Inner Circle production belongs to a long list of proud theatrical ancestors. The Moose Murders, Legs, Annie 2, Carrie the Musical, just to name a few. Now, where does one begin with this amazingly bad production? For one thing, I don't know where they got their plot ideas. We're shown a tennis-playing mayor who is obsessed with good manners and making friends with every 5-year-old who comes across his trail. He's surrounded by a staff of yes men, at least those members of the staff he's bothered to appoint or swear in. The city is at the brink of financial collapse, and all he can think about, all he can think about is selling his apartment. Come on, what city do these people live in? Anyway, there was one shining light on all of this. Let me be the first to say it. Broadway has a new mayor, and his name is David N. Dinkins. If politics doesn't work out for him, I'm sure he could go on to television. After all, he's already got some friends in the cable TV business. I give Have a Nice Dave 6 stars. One for every hour it seemed to last. This is Mr. First Nighter, Joe Papp.
Thank you, Mr. Papp. New York City officials today complained that the upcoming census of the city is bound to be inaccurate. As designed by the Reagan administration, the official census taker's map pictures New York City like this. So they'll only be counting people at the Plaza, Saks, Tiffany's, Bergdorf Goodman, and Le Cirque.
And now, with news of the powerful, the famous, and the soon to be indicted, let's go to our gossip columnist, Cindy Adams.
David, oh, shame on you. I told you, no tongues. I love him, Joyce. I love him. I love you, Mary. How sweet you look. Later, David. Shalom. Bess Meyerson and former mayor Ed Koch have settled their latest spat. It turns out Bess was disturbed and confused when she called Gracie Mansion the past few weeks and a woman answered. And Donald Trump has found a way to replace Ivana in his business organization and ensure future success in divorce court. Today, he announced the hiring of Sucrete Gable. Speaking of my close personal friend, the Donald, he told me again today that there's no possible way in the entire world that he will ever, 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 ever give Ivana more than the $25 million stated in their prenuptial agreement. He will, however, give her the chance to go down to the Trump Casino and try to double it. Leave it to Cindy to have the answer to the question everyone is asking. Where is Marla Maples? I discovered her hiding where she was certain she wouldn't be seen by anyone. The studios of Good Day New York. Well, don't get hostile. I just write it. I mean, really. I had a nice long talk with Marla, and she told me that as soon as she's out of this mess, she's going to dump the Donald and announce her engagement to Sir Rudolph Bing. Bad news for gazillionaire Adnan Khashoggi. City Corrections Commissioner Alan Seelaff says he's going to try to ease overcrowding at Rikers Island by sending 24 of the toughest cons to share house arrest with Khashoggi in his Olympic Towers apartment. Hey, who's being punished here? And speaking of tough cons, Leona Helmsley isn't even in the slammer yet, but that hasn't stopped husband Harry from beginning a new ad campaign for his hotels featuring the slogan, "The bitch is gone, and we're renting out her rooms." You know, boys and girls, old Cindy here has taken a couple of hard knocks lately. And I'd just like to take a minute to remind you all of something. You've heard the old saying, be nice to people on the way up because you're going to meet them again on the way down. Let's face it, when you're on your way down, I'm the note keeper at the gates of hell. When no one else will listen to your story, when God turns the other way, I'll be there ready to take a quote. Don't forget it, I'm Cindy Adams. See you in hell. You too, Mary. Look.
Thank you very much. I particularly want to thank my director, Wynn Handman, and our superb writing team, Al Franken, Fred Graver, and Larry Jacobson. I'm sure you've enjoyed the participation of my outstanding co-stars, Mary Tyler Moore, Ann Mira, Gregory Hines, Joe Papp, and Al Franken. Rounding out the cast were Fred Graver, Ken Sunshine, Laura Hart, Stanley Davis, and Arnaldo Segarra. Accompanied by this much talent, my acting debut was relatively painless, both for me and you. Highly professional technical support was provided by Christine Fife, assistant to the director, by stage manager Lloyd Davis, designer Mike Michonne, talent coordinator Travis Keyes, and costume consultant Pam Cruz. And extra thanks to the ladies and gentlemen of the press who provided more material than we ever could have used. Please join me in applauding these wonderful artists.